please stand if you're able for our call to worship. I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Our opening hymn is the great hymn, When Morning Gilds the Sky, number 487. Beautiful day, and we welcome everybody who's worshiping with us today. We especially welcome our visitors, both in person and those who are worshiping with us online today. We have folks worshiping with us as far away as Lake Burton and as far away as Kiev in the Ukraine. So we are thankful for folks who are worshiping with us around the county, the state, the nation, and the world through the wonderful media ministry that we have started during the pandemic and will continue so that folks can worship with us wherever they are. Just a couple announcements to highlight. First Sunday back with the Friendship Pad. They are there by the aisle on this side, they should be. Take a moment and sign it, put any information, update your email, address, phone numbers, whatever you would like or are willing to do. If you'd like to get the pastor's laptop, when you're not getting it, let me know on that. If you'd like prayer or desire a pastor call, let me know on that as well. When it gets to the windows, be sure and take and send it back this way so that we can look and see who's sitting beside you and get to know their names. And since we have faces now and not just masks, we can start to kind of connect those dots. So we'll look forward to getting to know one another through the friendship ad and in worship in the weeks and months ahead. We have beautiful flowers today that are given to the glory of God by Cheryl, mostly Cheryl. I paid for the record. But they're in celebration of the baptism of our granddaughter, Georgiana, in just a little bit. So enjoy the flowers. Hey guys, we're good. We have our session meeting Wednesday night, and I want to go ahead and announce food distribution this coming Saturday. Because it feels kind of out of sync somehow the way this month has run. Be here about 7:15, 7:30 was usually when we try to get the first cars through. We have 40,000 pounds of food worth about $250,000, and that's before inflation numbers. That's the old price that is set by the food bank, an estimated price per pound. More interestingly, if you've not heard me say this, we learned in the last 3 or 4 months that one out of every 7 meals in Raven County comes from our meals. So we are helping to serve a great need with a higher cost of food, some items doubling in recent weeks. More people will probably be in line. Their pennies are stretched, as all of ours are. So if you want to take some food to a neighbor or a friend, either get in line or come early, we'll preload you. Take it to someone who you know might be struggling, even though they either don't know about our food distribution or maybe embarrassed or too proud to come. Come pick up for them, take and deliver. We're glad to make that happen. So I hope to see everybody Saturday morning and start praying for no rain. We need good weather on Saturday morning. Can rain after 10, we're fine, but just not Saturday morning. I think all the rest of your announcements are in your bulletin. If you have not had a chance, last week's paper, our own C.J. Stockwell was featured. He was inducted into the Strength Coach Hall of Fame in Georgia. A wonderful article about C.J., Melissa, and the entire Stockwell family. Also, if you have not heard, we are still in a pandemic. Things have been more normal and better, but trends are going up in the county. We've had a few folks in the church test positive after recent trips to Atlanta or different places. So remember, these and these and these are your friends, just in case you forgot. Be prepared. Have the test kits online at home. When you feel bad, you don't need to be searching for a test kit, so have them. And if you think you have cold, body aches, just feeling lethargic, don't dismiss it. Take a test. Take a test a few days. Protect yourself and be sure to protect others. We will continue to have the windows open and the doors. For those of you that hated January, February, June, July, and August is your season. And I will hate June, July, and August because it's going to be warm in here. But we know fresh air is our safest friend, and we will continue with that. Increased circulation and high improved ventilation as well. All the rest of the announcements are in your bulletin. As our children come forward for our children's message, greet those around you with an elbow, a fist. Let's just, no kissing right now. It's a little dangerous, okay? But shake hands. Is how old Beckett's turning, is 4 years old. Fulton, you're 2 years old? And you are 6 years old?
Almost seven. Almost seven, excuse me. Yes, yes, ma'am. And you are how old, my friend? AKA Wolverine.
I'm five.
Five. Well, I got biscuits today because today's a special day. Today, Beckett's little sister, my other granddaughter, Georgiana, is going to be baptized. And baptism is a special, special day in the life of the church. And I read an article in Garden and Gun, a great Southern magazine, a wonderful, way better than Southern Living. You know, way just, Garden Southern Living is not quite the way it is, but Garden and Gun is far from the way we wish it could be, because it's like a big price tag magazine. By the way, Southern Living has never had a picture of a double wide. How can they call it Southern Living if never had a picture of a double wide? So, but there was this great article in Garden and Gun celebrating the wonders and the joy of the special occasion of sausage balls. Y'all all know what a sausage ball is?
No.
No. Well, you got an inside track because your daddy is the owner of the local Chick-fil-A. You win every day except Sunday is a lonely day, isn't it? You know, if I admit something, I crave Chick-fil-A the most on Sunday. I know it's wrong, but when I drive by, I want it so bad on Sunday. So I eat it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. How about that? In fact, my daughters, when I walked in and everybody said, "Hey, Pastor Don," said, "How often do you eat at Chick-fil-A?" So these are sausage balls. And say at Christmas time, these wind up on the table. And maybe at Easter, and maybe birthdays and special occasions. In fact, the article said, no Southern special event can take place without sausage balls. So yesterday, while everybody was doing other things, I made sausage balls at my house for today to celebrate Georgiana's baptism. And my family ate all but six of the sausage balls. So I have one, two, three, four, this one's mine, five sausage balls. Because today we're going to celebrate baptism, and with that, a very special moment, not only in Georgiana and her mom and dad's life, but in the life of the church. Can we say a prayer together? Lord, we give you thanks for special occasions as families and special occasions as a church family. We rejoice and give thanks for sausage balls and baptism. Amen. Now, as I said, today is a special occasion and a very special one for me. My first infant baptism at Raven Gap was, I think, 13 years ago. Where's Margaret? 13 years ago, right?
What, Sadie?
Yeah.
No, she was
15.
Yeah, it's a summer baptism, and she's 15.
So 15 years ago. So Sadie's now 15, so that's a nice record. I've not changed one bit, but Sadie's now gone from a baby to a 15-year-old at a learner's permit. I invite Lyndall and John and Georgiana and Beckett to come up front with me. We have a whole second row here. Aunt Stewart is here from D.C. Aunt Ellison is maybe going to try to FaceTime with us at some point from Kiev in the Ukraine, where she's reporting for the next month. Miss Cheryl, who I'm sure none of you know. And then John's mom and dad, Faye and John. So we're glad to have the Wachlowskis with us from Wisconsin and celebrate this special occasion. In the Presbyterian Church, we have both infant and believer baptism, and that's very important in what and why we think about baptism. That infant baptism affirms divine grace, that God loves us before we even know it, and believer baptism affirms our responsibility, our need to profess our faith in Jesus Christ. Beckett was baptized right here about 3.5 years ago. And it is an honor to baptize Georgiana today. So, John and Lyndall, these are important baptismal vows that you make, and I ask you to answer if you so believe. Yes. First, do you wish your child to be baptized? If so, say yes. Do you acknowledge yourself to be sinners in need of the saving grace of Jesus Christ? If so, say yes.
Yes.
Do you strive to live the Christian life to the best of your ability through the guidance of the Holy Spirit and Holy Scripture? If so, say yes.
Yes.
Do you promise to raise and love and nurture Georgiana in the faith so that when she becomes of age, that she will have the opportunity to make her own commitment to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? If so, say yes.
Yes.
What is the... I almost forgot these people. In the Presbyterian Church, we don't have godparents. You all are godparents, in effect. And these are awesome vows you make, but not vows you make alone. And I ask all of the members of this congregation and any Christian congregation to please stand. Do you, the body of Christ, promise to love, nurture, and encourage Georgiana in her faith each and every day of her life? If so, say, we do.
We do.
May be seated. See, that feels pretty nice, doesn't it? What is the Christian name of your child?
Georgiana.
Georgiana Lewis Wilkowski.
Hey,
sweet girl. This is not my first time holding her, so this might go well, and if not, it'll be very humbling. This is her big sister, Beckett, who is my assistant in all things ministerial and helps me every day with singing lessons, preaching lessons, and piano lessons. Yeah, there she is. Georgiana Lewis Wiklowski, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for Georgiana, for her life already bringing us so much joy. We ask your blessings upon her, her mother, her father, her big sister. May they grow in faith and love each day. May they never know a moment when they do not know the love of Jesus in their life. May they worship regularly, serve eagerly, give generously, and be a part of this great world in the name of Jesus. We ask your blessings upon Georgiana. May she always be healthy and well. May she find her calling and enjoy the glory of life each day. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. She is listening to me better than any of you ever have. Georgiana Lewis Wiklowski. Oh my! Child of the covenant. You are a child of God. So thankful you're here. We love you.
Yes.
She is so a happy baby. You want to smile again? Can you smile for me one more time? I'm going to give you back to your mommy while things are going well. Let's give the Wiklowski family.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, that will happen after the sermon. It'll be the best day ever. Let us pray. Lord, may we have the joy of a child in worship. May we rejoice hearing the hymns that are sung in the name of Christ Jesus. May we have a spirit of laughter, of innocence, of joy, of pure of heart. Lord, we give thanks this day for the opportunity to worship, to begin our week anew and afresh by gathering together as a community, as a family, in prayer, in praise, in hymn, in song, and in your word proclaimed. Lord, bless this service. May your spirit move and blow afresh upon us. May we feel the joy of parents with a beautiful, young, new baby girl. May we, as older children of God, realize the importance of this moment in her baptism, of our own baptism, in our journey of faith to this day. May we see how your spirit has comforted, strengthened, and guided us along the journey, the highs, the lows, the bumpy parts, and the smooth parts. Lord, we give you thanks. And we pray for those who are watching online, those who are joining us virtually. We lift up those who are sick or recovering from surgery. We pray for those who will have procedure in the weeks ahead. We pray, Lord, for our medical community and our first responders who continue to serve us with bravery and kindness and love. In Christ's name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The first piece of it is called Dawn. It is by Dario Marinelli. The second piece, uniquely and specially, is called Georgiana. As far as I can tell, it is the only piece of music in the world with the same name as my grandmother. Thank you. are your children, and you have blessed us greatly. We return to you a portion of those blessings and entrust that your Spirit will guide us to use it to your glory and to share your good news. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Simple, profound, beautiful little verses. Then people brought little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples rebuked them. Jesus said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." When he had placed his hands on them, he went on from there. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Some of the greatest memories of ministry for me are simply and always going to be children. Children in church. I love children in church. Nothing better than a church filled with children. Think Sunday after vacation Bible school. Think the fourth Sunday of Advent and our traditional, simple, yet magical and special simple Christmas pageant. Think the Sunday of Easter and after the 11 o'clock service, and if not the world's largest, the world's best Easter egg hunt on our front lawn outside of the church. One of my favorite stories of children in church is true. It is real, and it happened in a wedding that I was officiating long ago at Peachtree Presbyterian Church. Now, back then, I did about 100 weddings a year. Now, you can do the math. Now, you need to take out a few Saturdays aren't real good, although I had 7 weddings on April Fool's one year. I had 7 weddings on April 15th. It was all the groom's idea. I said, "Why tax day?" He said, "I won't forget it, and I always can say we can't afford to go out to eat. I got to pay taxes." A few days are special, kind of blocked off. You know, nobody wants to get married on maybe Halloween, although I've had that happen too. But then there are these things called football games and home games at Georgia put a dent in the wedding business completely because, you know, if Georgia-Auburn is playing in Athens or Georgia-Florida or Georgia-Tennessee or Georgia-Alabama or anybody but Vanderbilt, no weddings at all. But if it's Vanderbilt or like maybe, you know, a Wofford, a Georgia Southern, a Samford, a Furman, then we'll have a few weddings. If it's a bye week, every slot is booked, 7 weddings. Well, I have officiated at over 800 weddings now, 600 plus just in those first 6 years of ministry. And I became known, I think lovingly, as not Adam Sandler and the wedding singer, but instead Pastor Barber, the wedding officiant. The wedding preacher was what they called me. I still have folks chase me down sometimes at a mall, at a shopping center, at Costco in Buford, or most often the Atlanta airport, somebody yelling, "Reverend Barber," and it's usually a woman, "Reverend Barber, Reverend Barber." Everybody's looking, wondering, what has he done? "Reverend Barber, you married us, do you remember?" I'm like, "Oh, yes, I remember. Beautiful white dress, I remember." Gorgeous, gorgeous, what a special day. We were having dinner with friends at Waterfall one time, and all of a sudden, this older couple walked by and said, "Don?" I said, "Yes." They said, "Remember us from Peachtree?" I was like, "Yes, I do." I said, "You know, you married our daughter." I'm like, "Yes, I did." she's downstairs. We went downstairs, and her three children and her husband were all playing pool and ping pong, and it was a wonderful, great night. It's an honor to be a part of such a special day for couples. With that, I patented, trademarked a few wedding tricks, especially when it comes to children. Nothing more fun than to see a little girl about 4, 6, or 8 coming down the center aisle, spreading her little flower petals so that she has enough to make it all the way to the end, and then, because she has more than she realized at the end, just dump them all on the floor. Little girls 4, 6, and 8 love being flower girls. They love it. Little boys being ring bearers is a little different story. Little boys don't really like being in weddings. They don't really want to be a part of it. Little girls see it as their special day. The bride doesn't matter. It's their day and their moment. But little boys, I mean, come on. A rimmed black suit, a suit that someone else has worn before you, that's gross when you think about it. Hair that has to be combed, a bath that probably has to be taken, maybe even some product is put into your hair, and then there are those awful, awful patent leather, black, rented tuxedo shoes. There is nothing worse. They don't breathe. They're not natural. They hurt. They're awful, and you have to wear them. There's a great old story of weddings and children, and in that old story, I'm always reminded of those little black tuxedos on ring bearers. A little girl, little boy was sitting beside their mother, first time they'd ever been to a wedding. All of the things happen, all of the processional happens. The doors close, the music swells, the doors fly open. There's the bride, and the child asks the mother, "Why does the bride wear white? Everybody else has on different things. Why does she wear white?" And the mother says, "Because it's the happiest day of her life." And the child, as only a child could do, surveys the room again and looks at the mother and says, "Why does the groom wear black?" I love children in church. I know I will hear about that at the back door after church. But let's be honest. Men know this. The rented tux, it's an awful experience. It never fits quite right. They always leave something out. You have to make a run back to it. And you're supposed to return it all perfectly or they're going to keep part of your money. It's stressful. It's awful. It's no fun. And little boys are drafted. No, they are inscripted. They are forced to serve as ring bearers. And it always makes me think of that story. Because little girls, as we all know, love being in weddings. They love being flower girls, but little boys, it is only because they are threatened that they will be ring bearers. They wear these awful suits that are made of wool in the summer in the South of all places. Someone else's suit at that, shiny plastic shoes that were not meant to be put on feet, at least not human feet. And then before you realize it, all eyes are on them. And if that doesn't make things worse, as they walk down, if their mother or their grandmother or the other mother or the other grandmother or just your mother who is the matron of honor has their way, they're going to make you walk down the center aisle with a girl. Maybe even worse, your sister. And they're going to want you to maybe hold hands. Do you see where I'm going? Little boys don't want any part of the shenanigans of a wedding. They don't want to play any part of it. God forbid it's their sister that they have to walk down the aisle. And please, please, please don't make them hold hands. Are you starting to see why I love children in church? There is honesty in expression, honesty in action, and honesty at times in words. One wedding, a huge wedding, a sanctuary in Buckhead filled that seated over 2,000, well over 1,000 guests packed in, all in black ties, 7:30, fancy as fancy can get kind of wedding, 12 bridesmaids, 12 groomsmen, ushers aplenty, and I think there were 3 flower girls, and yes, there was one handsome 4-5-year-old. Rather be anywhere else in the world than their ring bearer. Little girls, as I said, love being flower girls. They love weddings. Little boys don't. They don't want to be there. So I developed some tricks along the way that help things go better. First, gummies. Any kind of gummy. Gummy bears, gummy fish, Sour Patch Kids. It doesn't matter. They're soft. They're gooey. And you put them in a plastic bag. They're almost quiet. When you're desperate, you pull them out. Round two, goldfish. Always goldfish. Goldfish are crunchy, but not too bad. And they work. They are always a crowd pleaser. The other thing is children don't want to be embarrassed. Children want to do what's right. They don't want to mess up. So you need to mark their spot. A simple thing. Ministers don't do this. Ministers are not the brightest people ever. They need to mark the spot. I have discovered a silver dollar, an Eisenhower silver dollar. It doesn't have to be the pure silver kind. Any silver dollar works. Put it on the floor and let the child know where to stand. It relieves so much pressure. They just want to do what they have to do, especially the ring bearer, and get out of there and eat. I've watched many a child walk down, look for their silver dollar, stand on it, and about midway through the service kind of do a, is it still there, look under their shoe. If they're good, I tell them they can have a silver dollar. By the way, I'm running out of silver dollars. If anybody has them, I will buy them from you at a dollar a piece, I promise. With that one particular wedding, that great, big, huge, magnificent, glorious, fancy wedding, the ring bearer came down, he took his place, he stood on his coin, and somewhere in the service, he began to get a little bored. He went from holding the pillow with the rings preciously tied in bows to kind of swinging it kind of like this, to then at some point, and I guess, to be fair, it was my fault because the wedding was a little longer than the rehearsal, so I had set an expectation that was not realistic. He went from swinging the pillow to it wound up on the floor in front of him, which I thought was interesting. And then somewhere about the end of my wedding remarks, before we started the vows, he began to walk in a circle around the pillow, just looking at it. He wasn't doing anything wrong, nothing bad at all, but the mother of the groom, his grandmother, was not very pleased. I could see it in her face, sitting right there about where Dot was going, stop. As I approached the vows, you could feel the pressure, and with that, Grandma's blood pressure. She tried to be inconspicuous and crawled down the center aisle of the church in front of the modesty rail to grab her grandson and take her back to the pew with her. Now, what she didn't anticipate were several things. He's stronger and he's faster. And as she got to him and he made that last circle around the pillow, just admiring the pillow and the day and the moment, she grabbed him. She grabbed him. And you can imagine what happened. He yelled out, "No! Don't stop! Mimi, no!" The groom's father oddly sat there quite content, as if he knew none of the people involved, with just a hint of a smile and a twinkle in his eye. Grandma had made a commitment now. She had him, and she headed back to the pew, and it wasn't easy. It was a fight. It was like wrestling a giant sport game fish on a tiny little line. She held on to him. He wailed, he hollered, he yelled, and then he began to do what 4 or 5 year old little boys do when they've been embarrassed in front of 1,000 people wearing black tuxedos. He began to kick, and he kicked, and he kicked, and Grandma dragged him down the pew that had no padding on the back, kicking those hard, god-awful plastic rental shoes. The sound you've never heard before, the sound that I will never forget. I had to stop the service. We watched as if in slow motion this play out. The pews there are like 80 feet long each. Imagine. Imagine a drum roll of kicking. No, don't. Please, let me go. Finally, she got him to the end of the pew. Finally, she wrestled him toward the emergency door in the transept. Finally, as she pushed that heavy door open, we're all looking that way. There was this moment, this pure, godly moment where the little boy looked back at me right in the eye, grabbed the frame of the door and said, "Help me!" The The door closed behind him. The muffled sound of tears moving away from the sanctuary down the hall to an obscure Sunday school class somewhere far away that would surely become a holding cell. There were some snickers. There were some looks. I had to get the ceremony back on track somehow. I looked at the bride. I looked at the groom. I looked at the congregation. I did my very best Rodney Dangerfield and said, "I know how he feels. Help me." It's our cry. Help me. It's our cry. From the beginning of time, from the beginning of time, from Genesis to Revelation, help me. It's our cry from the beginning of life. And I'm more aware of that, or more freshly attuned to that, being blessed with a nearly 4-month-old and a brand new 4-year-old staying with us. Georgie, the newborn, cries. She cries out when she wakes up. There are no words. There's just cries, and she cries out is her way of saying, "Help me." When she's hungry, she cries. Again, it is her way of saying, "Help me." When a diaper needs to be changed, help us all. Beckett cries out. Not as much, but when she does, oh my. When she needs something, she cries out, "Help me." When it's too high, or she's gotten in over her head, or she's done something maybe she was told not to do and has gotten in trouble, or things haven't gone well and she's now scared, she cries out. It's her way of saying, "Help me." Our passage today is so profound. It is so powerful and yet simple and beautiful, heartbreaking and heroic. Maybe next to the Nativity and the cross, there is no more profound image found in all of Scripture than Jesus with the children. Think of the times that it has been portrayed in sculpture, in paintings, in sketches, in stained glass window. How many of you had that children's Bible from the 1960s and 70s with that image on the cover of Jesus with the children? You can find this event, this moment, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Mark is the oldest gospel of which we have a manuscript. And with that, scholars think that Matthew and Luke drew heavily from Mark and another document that we don't have any evidence of. We have never found a fragment or any type of a scroll, but it's called Q. It's given this mysterious name, Q, because there are pieces that Matthew and Luke have, obviously from a similar source, that are not in Mark. I chose Matthew text because, quite honestly, it's more pleasant. But even reading it, you can kind of feel the uh-oh moment the disciples have. It's sandwiched interestingly on the way to the cross. Jesus knows where he's going. Time is running short. It is located between a section on divorce and adultery with the Pharisees who are out to get Jesus, and right behind it, a very rich, let's say, tech billionaire who wants to cover all his bases and know what he's got to do to have eternal life. The common thing in all three Gospels is these keystone cops that we know as disciples. Bless their hearts is all you can say. The Pharisees have the ability to do great harm to Jesus, incredible harm to Jesus, and they will. The disciples don't do anything to stop them from coming to Jesus, trying to set him up and question him. That rich young guy, he has the ability financially to ruin everything, to cause all sorts of problems, all sorts of trouble, and they do nothing there. But it is that moment where their bravery and their courage and their concern for Jesus rises up so highly. That moment when women and children are bringing their babies and their toddlers, mothers, grandmothers, all of a sudden the disciples think they are the Secret Service. And they're going to protect Jesus no matter what. Jesus won't have anything to do with it. He rebukes them. In Mark's gospel, it's even stronger. It says that he became indignant. It's the only time that word appears in all of Scripture. Indignant means that he is feeling a sense of anger and annoyance at someone being treated unfairly. Who doesn't know those words from the King James where Jesus says, "Let the children come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven." Barclay talks about that in his commentary on the Mark version of this story. He says that there is something unique about a child's faith and a child's spirit. He says that first there is the child's humility, and then there is the child's obedience, and then there is the child's sense of trust. He goes on with kind of sub-points to say that it is in the child's acceptance of authority that there is a time when every child thinks and knows everything their mother and father says is always right. It's a very short window, pre-3 years old, I'm pretty sure. It is seen in the child's confidence in other people. A child doesn't expect any person to be bad, do they? It's also seen in the child's short memory. As yet, children have not learned to bear a grudge or nourish bitterness. Even when they are unjustly treated, even when one of us is maybe short-tempered, we forget sometimes. But thankfully, the child forgets. And the child forgets so completely that they do not even need to forgive. Indeed, Barclay says, such is the kingdom of God. Today, we are reminded in the baptism of Georgiana of the kingdom of God and our birth into it through our baptism. Linda was not yet 2 years old when I started Greek school and seminary. Our family, Cheryl, Stuart, Ellison, Lindell, and I all went to seminary together. It wasn't something I did by myself. We made that decision as a family. We sacrificed financially. We sacrificed a lot of dreams to answer God's call. I remember the first paper I had to write, the pressure I felt, because when Stuart and Ellison did well at school and got a smiley face or a star, it went on the refrigerator. All of a sudden, I'm writing a paper for Walter Brueggemann. I'm wanting it on the refrigerator. The pressure was great to try to be a standard for them to admire and live up to. I became a pen pal and then a friend with the great missionary, Leslie Newbegin. And in it, we had a conversation about baptism. And he wrote that he did not remember his baptism. He was baptized as an infant, but that he was thankful for his baptism, that there was never a moment in his life when he did not know the love of Jesus. But he said the importance of infant baptism and believer baptism must always be held in tension. And for the most part, all of Christianity practices both. He said infant baptism affirms divine grace, that God loves us before we know that we need God's love. Believer baptism affirms individual responsibility, that we are called, we must choose to accept this gift of grace. We kind of do that both in our tradition with confirmation, in a moment where a child declares for themselves their faith in Jesus Christ, somewhere around the age of 12, but I will be honest, I have experience, met, and taught with children 6 years old who know exactly what they're saying when they say they trust Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And I have talked with children 85 years old who are trembling to say it for the very first time. Our sacraments in Christianity are so simple and so pure, so everyday, so right. Baptism and the Lord's Supper, water, bread, and wine. Every child knows before you eat, you have to go wash your hands. Baptism is what brings us to the table to join together with the family and eat a meal that nourishes us now and eternally. The last few years of the pandemic, we are all more aware of the importance of washing our hands. I always have been. That sign in bathrooms that say employees must wash their hands makes me crazy. Everybody should be washing their hands. You know we should have warm water. You know you should have a good amount of soap. The soap helps the germs to slide off. You need to rub your hands vigorously in the water. You should sing happy birthday to me 2 times through, basically. and then your hands are clean. We now even have hand sanitizer. Beckett will ask for it often throughout the day. Baptism is, for us as Christians, symbolic and real and a reminder our sins are being washed away by the grace given in Jesus Christ, His sacrifice. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Jesus is our hand sanitizer, our spiritual, our soul sanitizer, killing the germs of sin so that we might live more fully each day into and toward the kingdom of heaven. I love children in church. I love the noises. I love the shuffle of paper, the pictures drawn on the bulletin, the occasional paper airplane waiting to be flown. I love the giggles. I love the coos. And at times, yes, I love the cries. See, you, no matter your age, at this moment, you are all a child of God. Isn't that great? This worship is a hand-washing station. It's a lunch counter. It's a one-room schoolhouse. I get to serve. I get to preach. I get to try and teach children each week. No matter the age or grade in this sanctuary, there are PhDs in faith who are four, and there are 90-year-olds just starting kindergarten. May we as a church get it right, not make the mistakes of the disciples who rebuked the women and the children. In our new construction, we have a state-of-the-art nursery, meeting all the codes, ADA compliant. We'll have a new safe playground open to the community. We will always be about letting the children come. The children of all ages. And see and meet and be blessed by Jesus. The problem with being older, a grown-up, no longer a child, is a sense of not wanting, not asking, maybe not realizing, maybe it's just not wanting to admit, we all need help. Just like that little boy, a ring bearer being dragged out, may we not have to be dragged in, kicking and screaming by, we know in our hearts and minds that we walk in a sanctuary, we all need help. At different times, in different ways. I love children in church because I want them to know God loves them. God helps them. God guides them. God forgives them. Forgives them and us even before we know we need forgiveness. That God binds our wounds, kisses our ouches, bandages our scrapes, picks us up, and is more excited for us when we do something new than we ever could imagine for ourselves. I love children in church because I want them to run, to play, to lie in the pews, to laugh, to cry, to feel comfortable, welcomed, and look forward to being in worship and make memories and enjoy growing in faith and life. May God help us all. We need it. Times demand it. No matter your age, we are all just a bunch of kids, just children of God. And we cry out, help me. And like a parent, the most perfect parent of all, God responds, drops everything, races to us, sweeps us up in the strongest of eternal and everlasting arms, and says, it's okay. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for your love, for your welcome, for your acceptance, for your invitation. Let the children come and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Our closing hymn is a new hymn to you. You've never heard the words, but you've recognized the tune as morning has broken. I have heard the chimes. I hate those chimes so much at 12 o'clock on Sunday. We'll just sing the first verse. great senior pastor that taught me almost everything I know. Most of what he did extremely well, I have stolen and copied. Our order of worship, straight up Peach Street. The way I baptize a baby and lift them up and say, you're a child of God, isn't that great? Straight up Frank Harrington. I will never forget a Sunday early in my time on staff, I was assisting at the 11 o'clock service, which went to about 11, 12, 15, 12, 30, just for the record, so you know I'm not alone. At the Bennett Frank ended the service, he had gone over, he cut to a prayer, we sang one verse, and he started his benediction, and I looked over in the transept, and there beside Cheryl was Lyndall, Georgiana's mother, standing beside her, just standing about like Beckett in the aisle, just enjoying the moment. And I had my head bowed because there was that moment where you were supposed to go in front of Frank, and he'd stand at the front, and right at the front below the pulpit, and you'd go to the back door and shake hands. And I'm listening to the benediction, his famous benediction. And all of a sudden, I see Lyndall has broken free from the pew. I see Cheryl with a bit of a look of shock. I see Lyndall running up the 15 steps to the chancel right in front of Dr. Harrington. To me, all I could do was hold out my arms and scoop her up. And she tucked her head, and I held her. And I walked in front of Frank and went to the back door, and I prayed to God Almighty that he didn't see what happened. On Monday morning, he came right to my office. He sat down across my desk and made some small talk, and then he lowered his glasses and said, Dawn, your daughter ran to see you at the end of the service yesterday. I said, oh, Dr. Harrington, I'm so sorry. I hoped you had not seen it. He said, I see everything. I said, it won't happen again. I'm so sorry. She thought the service was over. And he looked at me and said, don't you ever stop her. Let the children come. Frank's benediction was this, and for that reason, how I baptize babies, I share it with you today. Remember, by the goodness of God, you were born. And remember that in the mercy of Jesus Christ, you have been redeemed. Remember that he walks with you every day to comfort you, to strengthen, and to guide. He promised he would. Lo, I am with you always. Remember, while others have called you servant, he has called you friend. And in the strength of that mighty friendship, go forth now to serve in the Master's name until we meet again. Amen.